We've all heard the saying, technology is changing every part of human life. I stay connected with my friends from around the world. I can ask my smart speaker to help me make dinner. And just last week, while I was abroad, I hopped on video chat to join my husband back home on a trip to the dog park. There's an app for everything, right? There's even apps to help you find the apps for that thing. But amid all of this technology, there are important parts of life we overlook, parts of life that are ignored by the technology we use to navigate the world. Consider Ashley. When I first encountered Ashley's profile, it appeared pretty typical for a 23-year-old woman. It included details like her name, her age, location. There were even messages posted by friends to celebrate a recent birthday. However, one thing was not immediately clear. You see, Ashley never celebrated that 23rd birthday because Ashley is dead. As an information scientist, I spend most of my day studying our online lives, but my career, it shifted when I started seeing profiles like Ashley's. I started to realize that our online lives, well, they don't end when we do. Today in my lab, we ask questions like, what does happen to our digital identities, to those Instagram photos or your emails after you pass away? And I work with companies like Facebook, who are seriously considering the role of technology when it comes to death and how we mourn. I know, it's not the most cheery career choice. But death, it's an important part of life, and increasingly, death is a more visible part of our online lives. You know, technology, it can help us connect, it can inspire us, it can amplify our humanity, but only if it's designed that way. So I wake up every day and I work to make technology worthy of our lives. Unfortunately, when it comes to our afterlives, we've got a long way to go. Consider all the ways dying 20 years ago is different from today. People would gather at a specific place and time to honor and remember the life of someone they loved. People, place, and time. Today, social media breaks these three open. In the United States, 1.7 million people on Facebook will die this year alone. And because so many of us live our lives online, our profiles, they become natural places for our friends to gather and remember us. As a result, more people will experience our deaths. That 1.7 million, those deaths will impact over 511 million friendships. Second, those friendships are increasingly scattered across the globe. And when our friends can't gather in person, they gather online. And finally, time. When we memorialize our loved ones has expanded. In my research, I've shown how the news gets out quickly. We see people flood to these profiles to express their shock, their remorse, and to begin to say their goodbyes. But in some cases, there's a kind of temporal slippage where some people may find out immediately, while others, they may not find out for days, months, or even years. Now, the activity will taper off over time, but a subset of people will continue to visit regularly. We can see evidence of this in the messages people post as they return year after year to mark the anniversary of the death. There are times during the year that people return as well, and I bet you could guess the days. You're thinking of New Year's and Valentine's Day and Christmas, and you're right. But there's one that might surprise you. It's the 4th of July. The 4th is a unique American holiday, one where we gather with friends and family, we throw some meat on the grill, we look up at the fireworks, and we talk about who isn't here. On social media, you can read messages saying things like, "You must have the most amazing view from up there." Over time, the messages people write will begin to resemble what you might expect someone to say when visiting a grave. People drop by to say hello, to let a loved one know they were thinking of them. They share memories, stories that allow all of us to gain a richer understanding of our friend's life, and updates. When we share news of an engagement or a new niece, we continue to stitch the deceased into the fabric of our lives. But even if these behaviors seem typical to how we grieved 20 years ago, the difference is that now they are data. The content we post and share can move through social media in surprising ways. And the messages we write to the deceased, well, they're no different. As a result, death is expanding beyond traditional settings like funerals, wakes, or even those profiles. It's becoming part of our everyday social media experiences. And this can result in some confusion. We're surprised when we see death announcements that can appear out of context in our social media feeds. We're stopped mid-scroll and reminded of a loved one who's passed away while checking our phone on the walk to our car. And while we cherish the opportunity to reflect on the life of someone we love, we are shocked when their death and our grief is treated irreverently. Consider, for example, Eric Meyer's widely circulated experience with Facebook's Year in Review. It's that feature that comprises a bunch of video highlights from the previous year. While Meyer's friends were all sharing videos featuring birthdays and vacations and parties, the celebratory video waiting for Meyer prominently featured the death of his six-year-old daughter. For Meyer, the encounter was nothing short of cruel. Back in 2009, there was an even bigger blunder. Facebook had released this feature called Reconnect. It encouraged you to write or post on the wall of a friend you hadn't been in touch with recently, especially if that friend had been inactive. And it made good sense. Facebook could let them know that there was a message waiting for them, the two of you could keep interacting, and everything would be good. Except, the algorithm running this feature was probably too inclusive with its recommendations. The internet quickly lit up with anger over recommendations to reconnect with ex-lovers. Spouses you would see daily offline, and perhaps most startling, friends who had a really good reason for being inactive. Yeah, friends who were no longer alive. But even in the midst of all of this shock and all of these complaints about Facebook's insensitivity, Reconnect also inspired a cascade of comments that were more reflective, like this one, written by a woman whose friend had died of cancer earlier that year. "Facebook tells me that I need to reconnect with you," she writes. "I wish it was as easy as picking up the phone or typing these few words." Reconnect served as a reminder that, yes, we die. But it also highlighted how little thought had been put into what should happen when we do. I suppose it could have been worse, right? As one man wrote on Twitter, "At least they're not deleting the dead." Now, of course, Facebook was quick to turn off the feature. But when the Wall Street Journal reached out to them and asked them how this had even happened in the first place, the director of communications simply explained that, well, the feature wasn't able to detect the human nature of our relationships. Not able to detect our human nature? On a platform designed to let us express ourselves, to share our lives, how can technology be worthy of our lives if it isn't designed for our entire lives? You know, and the sad part is, there's not much you can do about any of this. There are no features, there's no functionality, because by and large, we, the technologists, we haven't built them yet. Wait, actually, you know, it's worse than that. While technologists have historically ignored the dead, on many platforms, when they found out that you had died, they did delete your account. They didn't ask anyone or see if that's what you would have wanted. They just deleted it. It's like someone going into your grandmother's house after she's passed away and throwing away all her old journals. Just gone. When MySpace redesigned their platform in 2013, millions of memorials were destroyed, without notice, overnight. Today, next of kin can kindly ask LinkedIn and Twitter to shut down an account, but there's no option to get an archive or even memorialize these profiles. And Snapchat, I mean, don't get me started. As far as I can tell, they don't even have a policy. So what can you do? Well, you can add your online accounts to your will, and that's a good first step. But treating our online accounts as things to be given away, it's the equivalent of treating them as bank accounts, property, assets, logistical details to be handled after we pass away. Our social lives, how we're remembered, they are worth so much more than a bank account. As one man I interviewed said to me, our online profiles are our identities. How can you give those away? How does it even make sense? If we're going to approach this seriously, we're going to need to design for more than just death. We're going to need to design for our memories. Over the past 3 years, I've worked with a talented team at Facebook to do exactly this. Thankfully, Facebook stopped automatically deleting accounts back in 2007, but they knew they could do more. For the daughters wanting to change their parents' profile photos to something more endearing, to friends trying to share funeral details but unable to navigate the privacy settings, or for fathers who weren't friends with their sons on Facebook but now want to join and see the memories being shared. You might think, of course Facebook should help these people, but it's complicated. Whether profile photos, privacy settings, or friend requests, how can you know what someone who's passed away would have wanted? So what did we do? We approached these spaces as more than accounts. We approached them as legacies. We took a step back. We considered how people were using these spaces, what helped them connect, what was causing them pain, and then we designed ways to support them. It's called legacy contact. It's a feature that lets you select a close friend or family member, someone you trust, who can care for your profile after you've passed away. It's in your account settings. You could pull out your phone and choose someone right now. And yes, I realize that this is new territory, but it all started with one simple step. We acknowledged that people die. I'm inspired when I think about what our lives and our deaths would look like if all tech companies did the same. How would our technology change? There are so many possibilities. Google Photos could give us scrapbooks that would never fade. Pinterest, it might be the greatest lifestyle archive in history. And text messages, today's modern love letters, they could allow future generations to look into their past and see where they have come from. After all, today's data are tomorrow's memories. So we all deserve technology that is worthy of our lives, our entire lives, but we're going to need a broader perspective. As technology becomes a larger part of who and what we are, it's time for us all to take stock and consider how technology can amplify what we care about most and what makes us most human. Yeah.